Okay, so I'll start by thanking Bending Spoons for inviting me. This will be a journey through computer vision, which is a bit also my journey because I've been working on this field since 30 years. I'm never thought to change it. I'm so passionate on it. Okay, so maybe we can move to the first slide. Okay, so so it's a journey, so we'll see how computer vision started, how it has developed, how it's done now, and as Jeremy said, what we do a bit in this field in my lab. Okay, so the first attempts to do some kind of computer vision started in the 60s in distinguished labs like the MIT prominently. Then in the early 80s, computer vision started to be moved, found its way into real-world applications. And these applications dealt with improving industrial processes, mainly in manufacturing industries. So real working computer vision system started to be applied to inspect items, measure things, guide machines, and later robots. This is today still one of the biggest space, this process space is still today one of the biggest space of computer vision. Especially if you are in Italy or in Germany, these countries are countries in which manufacturing is the true backbone of economy. So if you are a computer vision researcher, as I am, or a professional working in Italy, you'll be exposed to many such projects. That has been my case as well. It's not, one might think this is a static space. It is not. It is growing. New applications are being taught in this space, like, for example, traceability, which means keeping trace of the lifetime of a product by reading codes, symbols, text, as well as process compliance, which is kind of new in this space, means seeing when a thing is being manufactured. This goes through steps, typically. Assembly A, then B, then C. Is it done that way, really, or there has been some mistake? So this is one big space, the traditional space of computer vision. What we see, however, now is also computer vision being used not to build better products, but as a product or as a key function in a product. Also, products that shall be used by everyone, like mass market products like phones, cars, digital cameras, any kind of smart glasses. So what's the big difference between the process space and the product space? If, as you know, the big difference in terms of a challenge to a computer vision system. If you had to use just one word, how would you say these application spaces, they differ because of what? Because of variability. In the process space, the objects are all the same. There are a few look the same. The capturing conditions are constrained. The camera is always the same. Light is precisely defined. Here, there's a very high variability because you could think, for example, to assisted driving. The shapes of the object that should be recognized by a computer vision system is huge. So there's a very big difference in terms of high variability here, low variability in the process space. So when computer vision started to be able to address also applications characterized by high variability, but when it found a way to handle it, this way being machine learning. Indeed, in the earlier days of computer vision, the whole system was fully programmed. If we think computer vision to be made of two main stages. Extract features, then take decision on top of these features. The earlier computer vision system were fully programmed for both stages. By the way, this paradigm works perfectly well in the process space and is still the main paradigm in the process space. The tools, all the commercial tools that you can buy to build applications in that space, work based on this paradigm that nowadays gets to be known as classical computer vision. In the past, it was computer vision, not classical. Then researchers started to be more interested, probably they were bored of the process space, and started to be more interested in recognizing, detecting faces, detecting pedestrians, classifying natural images. These are higher variability applications. And it was found that we can still program good features, like, for example, R features, OG features, SIFT features, but there was no way to program by hand the decision rules because of the high variability of the things that should be dealt with. And so machine learning entered computer vision, shallowly first, just as a mean to learn the rules, deeply then, when we found out that it would have been much better to learn the whole pipeline end to end from the raw pixel data to the desired output. This is the paradigm that is mainly used nowadays in computer vision, at least in the product space as well as in research, that goes under the name of deep learning. Mostly, but not only, realized through a particular network architecture, which is the convolutional neural network. So let's discuss a bit more this, what deep learning has brought into computer vision. Well, the first success dealt with image classification. We all know that in 2012, the AlexNet neural network won by an astonishingly large margin the ImageNet classification challenge, but then it spread kind of everywhere. Honestly, a bit surprising to me. I thought that you couldn't do much more than classification, which is pretty wrong. Okay? So, as far as I can tell, deep learning-based computer vision system, according to scientific benchmarks, deliver state-of-the-art performance across all computer vision tasks. Also, so-called dense tasks. And what I mean by dense tasks, and then I'll tell you why am I emphasizing these kind of tasks, I mean tasks at which the system is expected to output a prediction at every single pixel. Could be a categorical value, could be a numerical value, but it shall be, the prediction will be performed at every single pixel. Examples of such dense tasks are stereo, a task in which we have been working a lot. In stereo, you are given two images. Here I'm showing just one, but there must be two that look at the same scene from two different vantage points. And then you are expected to produce something like that, which is a disparity image. Disparity image means an image in which you record the differences between corresponding pixels in the two images. Disparity, we want disparity because it is inversely related to depth, so it's a way to measure depth. Somehow similar is optical flow, in which you want to match pixels not across two images taken from two perspectives, but across a video frame, a sequence of frames. And then we have semantic segmentation. you are asked to give a label to each pixel, and now even very popular, although in classical computer vision books you'll find that that is impossible, depth being predicted from just a single image. So, what's the matter with that, with dense tasks? Why am I emphasizing them? The matter is that if the network has to output a prediction at each pixel, to train it by standard supervised learning, you should provide it with per pixel ground truths, a ground truth value for every single pixel in the image. Pixel-wise disparity ground truths for stereo, pixel-wise vectors for flow, pixel-wise classes for semantic segmentation. Is that easy? Not at all. It could be either too expensive. In semantic segmentation, that is possible, but it takes from 1 hour to 2 hours to unlabel pixels for this task, unlabel images for this task, and maybe you would need a couple of thousands of them, or even more. So it's overly expensive. In other tasks, like stereo or flow, that's just impossible, because you can't match pixels by hand. So there must be other ways whereby these networks are supervised. Am I discussing these? Because these drives me into showing you some of the work that we do in our lab. So a first breakthrough in this space of deep, dense tasks was finding out that we could use computer graphics. So if you create a data set using a graphic engine, you have all the pixel-wise ground truths that you want. There's no problem. You can get vast amounts of training data, which are, however, synthetic. And what's the problem with that? We have then we don't want to test the system on images provided by the graphic engine. We want to test the system on real images. And so the problem is that, you know, they are come from different domains, and we know that the whole, at least standard machine learning theory, says that a system can generalize in domain, not across domains. So there must be something else done in order to make this work. So one thing that he's been doing is coupling synthetic data with aggressive, strong, sometimes even weird kind of data augmentations that help system generalize out of domain. In particular, this is done in stereo, where the most recent networks can generalize very well to real images just because they are trained with a lot of data augmentation. Or transfer learning, do a bit of fine-tuning, exposing the network to real data if you have such data. In some tasks, as I was mentioning, this is possible because in semantic segmentation, for example, we can have a bunch of labeled real images. In other tasks, this fine-tuning should happen differently. And so I go in this other part that shows means whereby we could do fine-tuning without ground truths. The first idea is leveraging on self-supervision. What is self-supervision? Let's say it's a sort of internal check that a network can do by looking for whether the predictions that it's doing are consistent with the observations. Although we cannot really compare with the ground truth, we can check whether the prediction in a way do explain the data. For example, in stereo, this is a left image, this is a right image, this is a disparity image. This disparity image basically implies a mapping between each pixel here and a pixel here. So, if the prediction are good, we can kind of pick pixels in the other image, so to hallucinate a left image, and the more this hallucinated left image resembles the real left image, the more the network is doing well. So it's a consistency, given the prediction, a consistency between the observations. Another strange sort of thing is using labels which are not labels. We might call them pseudo-labels, or sometimes also proxy labels. They are measurements coming from some external source. This source could be a sensor, could be an algorithm, could be another network. And we, you know, use them as if they were ground truths. Depending on how these pseudo-labels are obtained, they can be from very accurate, and in this case, they would be few in quantities, though you would have a few very accurate pseudo-labels, or could be abundant but super noisy. So there must be, so in that case, you would try to filter them before using them. Self-training is a little bit weirder, because is when the pseudo-label comes from the model itself. That is then trained, maybe in two or more steps, getting as pseudo-labels the predictions suitably filtered. This comes from our own research. We found out that in this space of dense tasks where there's not that much real supervision, learning jointly multiple tasks does help a lot. Because in a way, it's, I think, intuitive. Knowledge is real supervision is not that much. So the more you can share the supervision you have among tasks, the better. Because these tasks are oftentimes quite correlated one to another. So let's go through some of the work we have done in this space. This is the first deep stereo network that adapts itself continuously in real time while working. So it is synthetically pre-trained and does not make real good. So you synthetically pre-train it, then throw in the environment, and it will start doing badly. But then, time after time, it improves, because it continuously adapts itself. And this is done by, in this work, by using pseudo-labels that come from a classical stereo algorithm and that are properly filtered. For this to work well, obviously, this has to be done by a hardware-accelerated engine, such that you could provide the network in real time with images and pseudo-labels. We have published this, we have a patent pending on this, and currently developing a POC funded by the University of Bologna that might perhaps lead to some real-world exploitation. This is instead another work in which kind of I put together most of the ideas that I highlighted previously. This is, we address here perception from a monocular video. In this case, from a monocular video, we can predict depth, flow, semantic labels, motion probabilities, motion max, motion masks, so highlighting moving object, just with a single, from a single video. And this uses, as I said, most of the previously outlined ideas. Multitask learning, the network that outputs depth and semantics as a shared backbone and two heads. This because we did find that predicting depth with features which are aware of semantics does work much better. How this network gets supervised? As far as depth is concerned, we use self-supervision, so consistency through video, image consistency. And this is also done for the network that does optical flow. You can do just the same. While the network, the semantic head of this network is supervised with pseudo-labels got from a strong external teacher network. So another network which is much bigger and can output reasonably good pseudo-labels. Then we have also in this work the self-training. And this is because the optical flow network is trained in two stages. In the first stage, we just use self-supervision. In the second stage, we fine-tune the same frozen model using its own predictions, which, however, are ranked based on their confidence, thanks to information that come also from the other tasks, thanks to depth as well as semantics. Simple things like, if this is a rod, it's unlikely that it's being moving, okay? So these all predictions are made without leveraging on a single ground truth information. To prove this, we took a video from YouTube and then trained on a piece of the video and test on the whole video. You can see we can get decent depths as well as semantic labels and flow. Then I would like to come to our latest work. This was just presented in the last CVPR. Well, as I said, stereo networks are great. You can train them and they will generalize well out of domain if you do lots of data augmentations. But they still fail to handle difficult objects. By difficult objects, I mean transparent objects like glass, see the window here, highly specular surfaces, even mirrors. If you pick a state-of-the-art stereo network and try to reconstruct in 3D this scene, it will be fooled by the mirror. You'll see the bottle twice, while the flat surface of the mirror should have been reconstructed like that. So, in a project that we did in cooperation with Huawei Finland, they funded this project to us, we developed a new stereo dataset, the first stereo dataset, that is specifically focused on these difficult objects that technically are known as non-Lambertian, because they don't reflect light uniformly. Uniform reflection of light being at the core assumption or inductive bias, if you want to call it like that, in the whole stereo problem. So how can we get ground truths for these difficult surfaces? Assume we want to get a depth ground truth for that object which has, you know, all those reflections. We capture a couple of images that will be then associated with the ground truth we get. This is non-Lambertian. How to make it Lambertian? We paint it, okay? And it becomes opaque. Now, I was asking my colleague, why don't we paint every single point here with a different color? This would facilitate a lot matching images, matching pixel across pixels. So I asked them to do so. I'm joking now, okay? This could not have been done. But the idea is that, would this have been possible? Matching images, matching pixels, in which every point gets a highly distinctive color, would be super easy. So we do it virtually, right? So we project many, many, many color patterns on the scene, and we record not a single image, but let's say 100 of them, and so we get two, these are called space-time images, because they have also a time dimension that, in our setting, correspond to the different patterns which are projected. Now matching becomes super easy, because for every pixel, we have not just one measurement, but many, many measurements of many, many different colors. And so, we can feed these into, obviously, a neural network that will do deep space-time and come up with a very good ground truth image that can be released together with our data set. This actually works well because if you pick a state-of-the-art stereo network doing prediction, having never seen ground truth like this, it will fail. While if we fine-tune the same network with the training set of our dataset, it gets much better. Now, this, you know, if you go back to my previous definition, this might be called, not really ground truth, honestly, I would call them super accurate pseudo labels. And it's okay, there are a few, because although we don't paint manually, you know, we can't take thousands of these scenes. So in our data set, we release about 400 images that are split between the train set and the test set. You can use the train set to fine-tune models, and the test set alongside the submission website, we held secret the test set and allow evaluation to be done on this set. We call this booster because for two reasons. One was because this work was done at the time most of us were taking the third vaccine jab, and so booster was a name that was there. Then we found, okay, but maybe we can say this will boost stereo research beyond Lambertian surfaces. And that's the name, the reason of the name. Then, just to show you some other recent work, again, this was done in the project together with Huawei. Now we have more and more devices that feature multiple cameras with very different resolutions. We have maybe phones, these are the Meta glasses, this is a device used in industrial application mostly. So you have a setup that we called unbalanced, in which there are cameras at different resolution. Now, in this setting, it's pretty straightforward to do stereo at the resolution of the worst camera. But we wonder, maybe, what if we could do stereo, we can get disparity depths at the resolution of the best camera in the setup, not of the worst. Well, as people say in this case, the answer is yes, you can do something like that. For example, here we are matching a half megapixel image to a 5 megapixel image and get a very, very precise disparity map linked to the high resolution image. So the same resolution as the best camera in the setup. But you can do even more, because indeed, with this approach, you can get the output depths at whatever resolution you might wish. It's not limited in resolution. Indeed, we can upsample that up to 80 megapixel, starting from 5 megapixel and half megapixel, without noticing any artifacts. How that is done? Well, it's a continuous formulation of the disparity estimation problem. I'm not going into details, but the idea is that we have an MLP that probes continuously a feature space and output prediction. So you can probe whatever point you want without being limited by the actual pixel grid. Okay, I'm finishing. Just want to go back to the beginning of the journey. What about deep learning here? Should we use it? Does it make it sense? Is it happening? Or let's say that is the world of low variability, explainable things, so don't care about deep learning there. It is happening, it is happening. And the reasons are twofold. On one hand, it is happening because people now, I work a lot in this space, I know many companies, well, they are asking things that in the past they thought were impossible. There are also settings in the process space in which the variability is high, but in the past they just said, forget about that, we can't do this thing. Now they start to be aware that we actually can. So deep learning is being used slowly, honestly, to solve previously impossible problems. And this is another very important thing, to facilitate, make it much simpler, the development of computer vision systems. You don't have to program, you don't have to fine-tune, you can just train. But why am I saying this is happening slowly? Because there are two issues. One is that, yes, it's easy if you can train, but to train for most tasks that are relevant in the industrial space, you will need to unlabel thousands of images. For example, robot guidance, it's object detection, you need a data set, and if you change the object, you need a new data set. And also for, you know, explicability. In some industries, systems have to be certified. So an answer to this issue comes from a startup which just in 2020 came out from our lab. And the idea is called AutoAI. In this case, basically, you can get a labeled data set for object detection without a single manual annotation. How does it work? Well, we have a patent, and we have a robot which you put the object you want to then be able to detect, push a button, and then it will be scanned. Then, and here is the patent, okay? I'm not showing that much, but intelligence ways of doing the lighting and other stuff, this is the patent. Then we make it what we call a neural twin. What is that? So the object is now a neural network. It's no longer an object. Okay, it's a nerf, right? Then we use this nerf to automatically train a detector, and a robot picker will be able to pick these objects. And all this process has happened without a single manual labeled image. Okay, I skip this because, and then just wish to thank all the people working in our lab, without whom you would haven't seen anything today, okay? So that's it for my talk.
Thank you. Do you want questions or not? Would you like a question or not?
Yes, do you have time for questions?
Okay, I've got time. We are behind, and I'm sure you all want a lion bar now. But does anybody have a question for Luigi? Yes, sir.
Okay, so firstly, thank you very much for being here, for speaking to all of us today. So I heard you mentioning that with synthetic data and intensive data augmentation, you can get a model that has been trained solely on the synthetic data to work well with real-world data. So I have two questions in relation to that. And that is firstly, does this technique work mainly for low-resolution real-world images? Because I would imagine that computer simulations can't really estimate very well the information density that you have in a real-world image if you have more pixels in the image. So does this work well mainly for low-resolution images? That's the first question. And the second question is it safe to say that the accuracy of computer vision software, considering that it depends on synthetic data, is very tightly linked to the gaming industry, actually? Because the main reason for which we have those high-quality computer graphics is probably the gaming industry. So those are my two questions.
Okay, so let me say a couple of things. The first, the resolution, I don't see really that problem, because you can simulate high-resolution images very well with computer graphics, and then apply that also with real images. Indeed, the stereo data set that I was mentioning, we got images which are... another trait of this data set is it is high resolution, so 12 megapixels. So I don't see these as a limit. I didn't experience any problem related to resolution in applying this graphically driven paradigm. Then the second question is, yes, then for sure, if the graphic images aren't that good, they are not realistic, maybe they fail to capture difficult, they are not really realistic as, for example, in the perspective of robot picking, then this could lead to worse performance. But what I like to say is that nowadays we see a much stronger contamination between computer graphics and computer vision than in the past. These two fields have always been kind of intersecting, but now I see intersections really much wider. And these would lead, I think, to new computer graphic engines that will be more and more, less and less procedural, and more data-driven. And this would help also improving the quality of the graphic engines. Because if you think to techniques like NeRF that I was mentioning, you can capture, synthesize really, really realistic novel view without any 3D model of the object, but just from images. So in this field, I think that computer vision is going to fertilize graphic, because they are using neural networks, which are tools previously introduced in computer vision. And this could go back into computer vision, because they could create better graphic environments whereby we can train network able to generalize out of domain.
Thank you very much. Do you have another question here?
Thank you for your presentation. For our model, is there an estimated of the amount of image we should have in order to make model robust and have good prediction?
2053. No, really. I don't know. It's how many images. It's the question that you hear always when you try to exploit these in the real world. If you think to a company in a real project, they always ask you, how many images? Unfortunately, I don't have this answer, and I don't think anyone has. So what I can say is that the more the better, for sure, and follow good practices like split the data set, even though it's small, into a train and validation, and just forget about the test set, and then try. And if it is not working, you see underfitting, you need more data. If you see overfitting, you regularize. That's it. I don't think there's this could be probably interesting point of research, but I don't think there's an answer so far.
Okay, last question. Right here, the lady right here.
So my question is there any progress in self-training in the task of object tracking?
Yes, it's, let's say, a little bit less developed, but see, yes, there have been recent papers also in the last CVPR trying to apply deep learning in object tracking. I think that using pseudo labels with self-training is something that can be that is really useful in this space. Although when we think of pseudo labels, the key point is always how can you assess their confidence? The way that, you know, there are not really robust approaches nowadays to assess the confidence of a network that is predicting, because most of the time they are confidently wrong. So this is another space of research that I think is very important.